Take your Bibles and turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I want to read just a few verses. Brother Norman's had us in this chapter in 1 Thessalonians the last couple of weeks. I want us to drill down verses 16 to 18 today and think about God's will for you and me. 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 to 18. If you don't have your Bibles with you or a Bible with you, then it's on the screen so you can follow along. Text on the screen. It's very brief, very powerful, and a key to understanding God's will for our lives. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. We just read together. The inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient word of God. And it is sufficient. And if we hear it and embrace it, follow it, commit our lives to it, we will discover in more clear and powerful ways God's will for our lives. Thank you. Be seated. In 40 years of preaching, I have never sat down to preach. Circumstances, and being a good steward of circumstances, dictate that necessity today in the near future as the doctor gives us guidance into what my uncle can and cannot bear. I want to say a few things before we delve into the text today. Just so grateful for so many things. So grateful for the media ministry, something that we would take for granted sitting in here. The screens run, the sound works, but I'm talking about the extended reach of that. Being in the hospital, rehab one Sunday and then in my home last Sunday. Being able to go to our website and access the live streaming services was such a blessing. I'm so thankful for Linda here setting the website up where we can do that. If you haven't seen our new website, you can check. I'm so grateful for Michelle Wiggins and who has taken us into cyberspace and made possible the internet broadcast of our services. You get able to read the scriptures, to follow along the outline, to sing the lyrics of the songs, being sung, just a great experience. So grateful for Brother Norman Hare stepping in, and I was able to listen to the two sermons. What a blessing that was to hear the exposition of 1 Thessalonians 5. How pertinent to us. And deeply convicted the first Sunday for each student. And just really challenged and grateful as he continued that the next second Sunday. So grateful for the men who stepped in and led the life group over which I'm a facilitator, led the prayer meeting. I'm hearing some great feedback from so grateful in so many ways. I'm so grateful for my wife who has donned her nursing cap after having hung it up years ago and has been engaged in some intense nursing. And she's kept her promise to the doctors and the nurses and the therapists, and she is really cracking the whip on physical therapy to make sure that I make the progress I need to make. And if I got the rest of that, surgeon this Wednesday, Lord willing, and looking for me and the unexpected problems that took place when I fell. After having had surgery, when I fell Thursday night in the hospital and broke my left ankle, so I'm pretty gimped up, but I'm feeling really well. That's God's goodness to me, and God hearing your prayers. I've been praying earnestly. It's great kindness. I like Joshua, had a little chagrin that we came up one box short. But it's a good cause. I want to commend you. I think I'm right that last year simply mentioning this Operation Christmas Child Shoebox, I think we have like 15 or so boxes that are in there. 63 boxes this year. So I've got some ideas about building funds and things like that. Thought about maybe if we were ready for those dunking pools, if we set a goal or risk a goal, we might have to do some fun things with that. But God bless you on the way that you respond to some of that. We're in my favorite season of the year, Thanksgiving. I love Thanksgiving. We have a wonderful Christian heritage in this holiday we call Thanksgiving. So it seemed to me, it seemed good to me, in the light of how we're going to have us the last couple of Sundays, and with the season we're entering into, and the question that comes up from people from time to time, and even I'll confess to you, lying in the bed at the rehab center on Saturday night, the 31st of October, wondering from day to day, what is your will in this? I don't understand this. Glad to need grace and surgery because it would make me better. I don't understand the broken ankle. And yet, confidence that God has a purpose in everything that comes to us. He takes an opportunity to reflect on some things, and I want to just us to take a look at these verses today. Hopefully challenge you to think about, first of all, God's will for you, and then the climate. That's what I think this passage teaches. The climate in which we are most likely to discover God's will for us. Okay? In a written passage like this, it's like we can do God's will the hard way or we can do it the easy way. This climate, I think, shows us an easier, clearer path to travel as we discover God's will. There's a book I want to commend to you by R.C. Sproul. It's called Can I Know God's Will? It's about 100 pages in length. It's an easy read. And at the beginning of that, he cites an exchange from the story Alice in Wonderland between Alice and the Cheshire Cat. You may remember she's lost in Wonderland. She came to a fork in the road. A panic stung her as she stood frozen by indecision, not knowing which way to go. She lifted up her eyes toward heaven, looking for guidance. Her eyes did not find God, only the Cheshire Cat leering at her from his perch in the tree above. Which way should I go? She murmured. That depends, said the cat, fixing a sardonic smile on the confused girl. Depends on what? She asked. Depends on your destination. Where are you going? The cat asked. I don't know, Alice said. Then said the cat, it doesn't matter which way you go. You don't know where you're going, it doesn't matter which way you go. And yet, as followers of Jesus Christ, we have a clear sense deep down in the deepest parts of our being that we're going somewhere that God has designated. We would sing things like, I'm bound for the promised land. Or will you come and go with me? Peter exhorts us as strangers and pilgrims. Where are we going? I want us to take just a few minutes. I want to give you some biblical background on this idea of God's will. When you look at the word groupings in the scripture, the New Testament particularly, you find two primary words that come up. One is the word we would pronounce it boule, B-O-U-L-E. If you transliterate it, spell it out, it's boule. The other is thele, with T-H-E-L-E-L-A. One speaking of direct, intentional actions and desires. The other a more of emotional desires cultivated by things that have been revealed. And so you have these two words, and out of that, as you study this, for example, when you see the development of Bule, it's used of God quite a bit in the New Testament, and it becomes his decreed will. It's God's providential plan. It's predetermined, it's inflexible when we talk about God's boule, God's decree. We, in our confession of faith, the second level of confession, the Baptist confession, 10:9 says that God has decreed all things whatsoever come to pass. It's done so in such a way so as not to be the author of sin nor violate his call. The free work of second cause. It's talking about God's decree, the written will of God's decree. But there's also this the land of this other word grouping. It's the will of his precepts. And so when you start looking at the categories, the way that you discuss God's will, you discover that there's the decreed will of God, his decree. There's the preceptive will of God. It's what he has spelled out in Scripture. So sometimes his decree, his precepts coincide. And then there's his dispositional will, which is the area in which we operate, making human choices in the context of that which has been decreed by God and revealed by God in his word. And then there's the category of the secret and revealed will of God. And you have to keep those in mind when you're studying and discussing the idea of God's will. Acts chapter 2 would be an example where in verse 23 that Jesus is spoken of as this Jesus who was delivered up according to the definite plan. That's the boule there, that's the free will. And foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of the Holy Spirit. So there's God's decree, the delivering up of Jesus. There's the responsibility of sinful men killing Jesus. They sinned against the precept. They sinned against the sixth commandment. You should not kill. These things coincide, and we need to understand God's will along those categories. And this is what I want to focus on this morning. Another example I will give you, 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slow to fulfill his promises, some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing or not willing or not desiring that any should perish, but that all should have repentance. This is God's dispositional will. And yet, we see a dispositional heart of God. And people will perish because they violate his preceptive will, his revealed will. When you refuse to trust in Jesus Christ, when you refuse to commit your heart and life to him, you have sinned against God by not exercising faith. And that failure to exercise faith ends in the punishment of eternal damnation. But God's disposition, it's not his desire. And she perish. And he manages both of these without contradiction. What I want us to turn our thoughts to today, you think about the secret will of God that is kept to himself. And the revealed will of God. Deuteronomy 29:29 has been a watchword for me for years in terms of managing the will of God. There are things God has shown me in this part of my journey that I embrace because he is good. And there are things he's withheld from me that are in his secret will that I simply will acknowledge and say, even so, Lord, for it seems good in your sight. And Deuteronomy 29:29 gives us these categories. The secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things that are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law. And so when we're thinking about God's will for us concerning employment, God's will for us concerning where to live, God's will for us in terms of choices day in and day out, choices of life. As a child grows into adulthood, considers God's will for a spouse, a life mate. Many of those things they're hidden. They're secret. They're not immediately revealed. You can't turn to a place in the scripture, chapter and verse that'll tell you where to live. We can go to Acts 17 that tells us that God has set the bounds of our habitation. That he bounds us to where we're going to live, but we cannot go to a place that will tell us you need to live in Ascol. We can go to the scriptures that teach us about how wonderful marriage is in the sight of God, marriage in the Lord. The principles to pursue that, what to look for in a helpmate, in a husband, a wife. You won't find a name there. And so we bound in life, wanting to know the answers to God's secret will for us as it unfolds daily. And the way we find that, this is the point I want to make, the way we find that most convincingly, most clearly, most confidently, is when we practice the things that He has revealed in His Word. Joshua mentioned a while ago the constituent elements of worship. I can tell you that if you do not, as a matter of course, if you don't prepare your heart for worship, if you don't come to engage in worship with your Bible, or with access to a Bible, if you don't engage in praise, knowing that as we sing praises to God, He inhabits the praise of His people, He draws near. If we don't come with hearts, as a great little book Brother Gene Russell gave to me last year before he died, called Expository Listening, if we don't recognize the importance, Spurgeon said, in many respects, it's more important that you prepare your heart and mind and ears to hear the Word of God as it is to prepare to preach the Word of God. If we're not engaging in those things in worship, we will not worship the Lord in spirit and in truth as he's called upon us to do so. By the same token, in this text today, as it concerns God's will for you and me, until we lay hold of these imperatives, and they are commands, that we may stumble and fumble and not be clear and content as we try to discover God's will for our lives. So I want us to see three things just for a few minutes here today. Preparing this sermon, not really knowing physically what I might face in terms of challenges to preach to you since I found that I lost some physical strength through the surgery and the aftermath of that. Three things I want you to think with me about here. The command, first of all, to rejoice always. Second, to pray without ceasing. Third, to give thanks to God in all circumstances. If we're going to discern God's will for our lives, we need to cultivate these three practices that He has revealed are His will for us. Do you follow that? The text says, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances. For why should we do this? Well, it's not only right to do it, not only reflects the beauty of the Christian life. For this rejoicing always, this praying without ceasing, this giving thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. People come to me from time to time and say, Pastor, typically it's young people, but not exclusively. Pastor, I want to know God's will for my life in this area or in that area. And so I'll ask them some questions. Well, tell me about your daily Bible reading habits. Well, tell me about your daily prayer habits. Well, tell me about your frequency and encouragement and fellowshipping with the saints, being around other believers. You go down a little checklist, and when you discover your folks are not engaging God in His Word, where He speaks to us, if we're not engaging God in prayer, then really, what we have to be honest with is that it's not so much that we want to know God's will for us, as it is we want to know what's behind door number one, door number two, and door number three, as we get ready to try to choose on these doors. And I will submit to you that if we will cultivate these habits, spelled out in these three verses, and we'll see some things happen in our lives. Door number one, two, or three will open up. When the other two, you couldn't open up with a hammer. You couldn't kick them down. When we're practicing what God has said, this is my will, this is my revealed will for you. So let's look at these. Rejoicing always. This is a command to be filled with joy. In fact, you could read it, all of you, because it's a plural. All of you, be filled with joy continually and eternally. Now let's admit, we're frail creatures of dust. We can have every intent. In fact, we'll come in today, drive down the state today, and we'll leave this place with a renewed commitment to have a disposition of rejoicing. A heart filled with joy. When we think about the things for which we have to be joyful. We walk out into the parking lot and have a flat tire on our vehicle. And that joy can be quickly snatched. It can diminish. So when we talk about rejoicing always, the point is not to make ourselves susceptible to one of the devil's tools. You know how the devil operates, don't you? When you've been neglectful, perhaps, in your prayer life, and you make a renewed commitment, I'm going to pray every day, or I'm going to read the Word of God every day, I haven't been doing that, and then a day comes that the day unfolds and you find that you have not spent time in the Word of God. Because see, the devil wants you to make this go, well, I'm going to do this and never miss another day. And when you do that, he's got you. He's got you. And he'll work you over with guilt trips and accuse you of being a hypocrite. We're not talking about that. We're talking about cultivating a disposition, a tenor in life that commits to intentionally rejoice, intentionally be full of joy. An interesting thing happened to me that nobody knows about but me, and you'll know it now as I share it with you. As I was lying in the rehab center, because you see, my plan was to have surgery, leave the hospital by Friday, Lord willing, and come home and get home health physical therapy on Monday. Well, Thursday night, in a way that people have asked me what happened, and I really can't recreate for anybody what happened, because I kind of got brought into the whole thing when I fell. As I was falling, I heard my ankle pop. It was a very loud, distinct pop. And I found myself on the floor in quite a bit of pain. I had a water cooler arrangement set up to my right knee, running cold water over my right knee when I had surgery. And it turned over, and I was lying on the floor with ice cold water all around me. On me. And I don't know how long I was there. The nurse came in and was quite dismayed to see me there, as I was dismayed to be there. And got me back in bed, took an x-ray the next day, sure enough, the ankle was broken. And I was lying in bed, so the game changed at that point. It wasn't going home, it was now going to send you to a rehab center. Went to the Highlands, some nice facility. Didn't expect to see something like that at this point in my life, but it's a nice facility. Joanna works there, my daughter, she's a nurse there, does a splendid job. But I was lying in bed Saturday, I remember this, it was October 31st. Everybody was gone, Karen had gone for the evening. I was lying there, just thinking. And I began to weep. And I wept like a baby for I don't know how long. Just wept. I mean, wept in a way that I tear up about things. But I mean wept. Guffawed. If somebody would have walked in, they'd have thought I just had a death. And somebody just called and said, so-and-so died. It was just that intense. I think things were catching up with me at that point. And I faced at that moment rejoiced in, knowing that what I received was a difficult promise, an adverse promise, a setback to my plans for rehab had come at the hands of a gracious God who had done so much for me that all I should do is rejoice. Now, will I never grumble again? I wish I could tell you. I know me better than that. And I'm in a world, a fallen world around me. But you know what? A renewed commitment to rejoice in this. You know, Job could say, and he experienced difficulty at a level that I can't even imagine. But he didn't know the whys and the wherefores of what was going on around him. Why one tragedy after another? Here's what he says, that I know. See, Job could have spent his time with what he didn't know. I don't know why this. I don't know why that. I know that my Redeemer lives. And if you'd ask Job, are you going to stand in the last day? He said, I don't know about that, but I know that my Redeemer lives and that he will stand in the last day. And a standing Redeemer is all I need. In fact, Job at one point said, as he wondered what else what was left for God to take away, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. It's not a place anybody would volunteer to be. Having been brought there, Job knew God in ways he would have never known had that path not been unfolded to him. So rejoicing always, disposition of joy. We look around us and in the last few weeks, things have seriously intensified in our world. Much upheaval, much destruction, much taking life. Much concern about it. Much more concern about the leadership we have. And yet, folks, I want to say to you, we should view these things through the lenses of a sinless Savior who gave his life to die for us and rose again to prove that he did die for us and that he had the power of death and hell, and Hades, that he had the keys, and that he would lead us as his captives, he would lead us captive. That when we see the destruction, the desolation going on in the world around us, it would be easy to get discouraged, despairing. I want to remind you, this is not superficial, that should my life or your life or the lives of many of us be taken through terrorism, as awful as that would be, as despicable as that would be, as wrong as that would be, it would simply be the vehicle to usher us into the presence of our Lord. You see, though he slay me, yet shall I trust him. And we can rejoice in that. We can rejoice in that. Be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. So this first command, it's a verb, imperative verb, rejoicing always is this challenge to cultivate a disposition. And I want to do that. And I want to repent to you in times when I have grumbled in your presence. But let me say something to you. My grumbling does not edify. My grumbling does not build you up. My grumbling may actually be the straw on the proverbial camel's back which drives you to further despair and discouragement. My prayer is that as I increasingly cultivate a disposition of always joy, that I'll be able to slosh some of that in front of you. It'll be cool and refreshing. and building up and helping you and me to be more hopeful. You see, folks, there's not a thing that's happened recently in the news, or historically, as far as that goes, that has changed God's secret, hidden will, yet to be unfolded, where he will come to blow history out like a candle and roll it up like a scroll and usher you and me into the kingdom of our God and of his Christ. So we read earlier, Revelation 11. The kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our God and of his Christ. Handel took that and worked that into one of his many segments of his oratorio, Messiah. And it's a great piece that crescendos in the piece to Hallelujah. Rejoicing always. My commitment to you. And I ask you to do this for me. Commit to save yourself so that if you do catch me and not rejoicing, you rejoice and bring me back to where I need to be. You see, Philippians 4:4 says, rejoice in the Lord always. And Paul says, in case you missed it, again, I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. Did you hear what I said? Rejoice in the Lord. When we think about him, you see, we have a Savior. A man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and yet, if you followed him around, you would have to say, the tenor of his life was joy. Joy. Secondly, pray without ceasing. Again, one of those exhortations. It's a command. It's a middle voice. So praying yourself without ceasing. Don't fall into the devil's trap. I'll tell you what, from here on out, every day, there won't be a day go by that up for the devil to make you a failure. No. And it's further not saying, because prayer is so important, that it is important that we should get up in the morning, get on our knees, and stay on our knees all day praying unceasingly until we fall asleep on the side of our bed and slide back into our bed at night. Wake up to do this. That's not what we're talking about. Praying without ceasing is to cultivate a disposition, what I call a prayerful disposition. It is recognizing praying. Times for prayer. Praying aloud, praying quietly. Intentionally setting aside times for prayer. But it goes beyond that. A disposition of prayer. I told you about my brother R.F. Gates, and he, more than anybody I've ever known, had this disposition. If you spent time with him, and my kids got to do that, and Karen got to do that, we could be walking along in a conversation, and he would just suddenly break out of prayer about that. I remember driving with him in Florida. Church building. It was on Saturday. In the middle of our conversation, he said, "The Lord, I don't know if the gospel's ever been preached in that place, but I pray that tomorrow someone will stand to preach the gospel and then say what we say," just spontaneously breaking out in prayer. He had a habit. He was very health conscious. He fought diabetes all his life. He would walk around a bayou in Shreveport with his Bible. He would spend the time praying, and he would pray aloud. And on more than one occasion, people called the police because there was this crazy man walking around and around, talking to himself. And on more than one occasion, the Shreveport police had the opportunity to stop, ask him what he was doing. And it was a great gospel opportunity for him. Well, I was just praying, "Officer, do you pray? Do you talk to God?" disposition, a prayerful disposition, so that these, what the Puritans call spontaneous prayers, which is you rise up, you see somebody in need, you pray for them. The Lord meets a need, and thank the Lord for that. A quick, speedy answer. What a breath of fresh air. Here again, how that boosts a joyful, always attitude. Because in a spirit of prayer, in a disposition of prayer, prayerful disposition, where we're connected, consciously connected to God, asking for the Lord's blessing upon something we're about to engage in, asking for answers, for insight. You know, and I'm not chiding anybody here because we all do this. We need to cultivate along with this the attitude that when we tell somebody we're going to pray for them, that we pray with them right there. I don't think you have any idea what that does to a person. I'm encouraged when people say, "I've been praying for you, preacher." You have no idea how you've encouraged me in these days. I hadn't been away from preaching this long in over 12 years. I'm not an easy person to live with when I stay away from preaching this long. I love it. I love it as much as breathing. You praying for me is God's used that. And brought me back in a timely way. One of the most encouraging things you can do is pray over a person. Pray with a person, pray for a person. On the spot. And I believe in my own life, the more connected I am to a prayerful disposition, the more likely I am to pray on the spot with a person. That will come to where it needs prayer. So, rejoicing always, praying without ceasing. And the third thing I'm going to touch on here, and because this is my favorite season of the year, giving thanks in all circumstances. Giving thanks. Thanksgiving. One of the things I love about this season is it brings us back to that. We can wander far away. When you begin to think about Thanksgiving Day, what we're going to eat, who we're going to gather with, we try to do different things around our house. Kira, what was it we did last year? We had these rocks. Did we write on the rock what we were thankful for? Passed a rock around there right at the table. Right, what they were thankful for, and they put it in a jar. I think we still have that little jar, don't we? We'll probably break it out this Thanksgiving to read those notes of Thanksgiving. Giving thanks in all circumstances. And I submit to you, that's a challenge. All circumstances? Yeah. Because you see, there's some folks floating around on TV and the internet who have this kind of I think of the grinning Cheshire cat, the big grin. Well, praise the Lord anyway. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about a deep-seated heart of thanks. No matter what problems you're facing, no matter what news you've heard, no matter what challenge has arisen. See, I think that's where the Lord took me. The Saturday night, October 31st. When I got honest, that I was frustrated with the detour. I call it a detour, just God's making plan on where he wanted me to be. And I faced this, and I thought, are you you thankful to God? And really, when you face that, if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, the answer comes back, how could I not be? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us, in such an incredible gesture of love and grace, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us, how then could I believe that he will do anything other than freely give us all things needful? You see, it's the argument for the greater to the lesser. If God gave his son for you, do you think he'll hold back anything good for you? The answer is no. In fact, that's the way it's asked in Romans 8. And Paul says, what should we say to these things? Here's what we say. If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not with him freely give us all things? The answer is, there's no reason to believe he won't. You see, the way that you give thanks to God in all circumstances is you never forget Jesus Christ. You never forget the gospel. For me, an unexpected broken ankle with a side detour to a rehab center, which parenthetically I'll say, looking back, my progress has been hastened for being there and working with me 5 days a week. Physical therapy and occupational therapy and all the stuff that we had there expedited my healing. I believe my physical therapist who come to the house took that to say, you're amazingly far along. But Jesus Christ, preach the gospel to yourself every day, folks. Or pray, dear God, when I'm not even I'll have my wits about me enough. Bring somebody alongside me who will preach the gospel to me. Who will remind me Jesus Christ died for me, you know. Don't let a bad angle make you think God's forgotten. Jesus Christ died for you, you know. Don't let discouraging news medically make you think God's forgotten you. Jesus Christ died for you. He rose again. He's ascended on high. I don't know what you're thinking about right now, but what he's thinking about you. He ever lives at the right hand of the Father to pray for us. Giving thanks no matter what the circumstances. Because you see, when we don't know God's will, the secret will of God for our lives unfolding daily, we do know that rejoicing always, praying without ceasing, giving thanks in all circumstances is his will for you and for me. And if we will commit to practice this which we know is his will, then I believe the unfolding of his will comes with greater clarity. I believe the unfolding of his will comes being received with greater hope and confidence and joy as opposed to the oh me, oh my, oh no disposition that may come. When we're not tuning in to the frequency that he says is his will, and I believe is the context, the best place in which to discover the unfolding of his will for you. So let me close with these lessons. Four lessons I want you to take with you today. First, if you want to discover God's will for your personal life, you'll remember that he has commanded his followers to rejoice continually. Lord, I want to know your will. Train yourself. Am I rejoicing continually? To the extent that that I am doing that, it will tell me the seriousness with which I'm asserting that I want to know God's will. And it'll take me away from the danger of I want to know what's behind door number one, door number two, door number three. I'm about to make a choice here. I'd like to get a peek if I could. Secondly, if you want to discover God's will for your personal life, you'll remember that He has commanded His followers to practice a continually prayerful disposition. Learn to thank God when the manifestation of His goodness unfolds in your presence. I've been thinking a lot recently about that. I went from not being able to get up in a chair like this to being able to get up in a chair like this. That's reason for thanks. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Talking to God. Meet somebody with a need. If you don't get to talk with them, you just observe the need, pray for them. If you get to engage them, pray with them, over them. Pray without ceasing. Third, if you want to discover God's will for your personal life, you will remember that He's commanded His followers to give thanks no matter what the circumstances might be. And learn to meet the circumstances with, oh, wait a minute, I could become dismayed about this. I could be undone about this. Or I could stop and thank the Lord for all the many goodnesses. And finally, we wrap it up. This to me is so important for us to take this. If you want to be a Christ follower who rejoices continually, prays continually, gives thanks continually, you will first of all remember that past mercies of God shown to you. Remember the past mercies of God that have been shown to you. It's in this season of the year when we move toward Thanksgiving that we should be constrained to stop and count our many blessings. Name them one by one and you will be surprised at what the Lord has done. Remember His past mercies. They are many. Secondly, recall God's promises presently spoken to you. His word is filled with promise. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. So if a terrorist weapon happens to take my life, it did not prosper. It became God's tool to take me where I want to be anyway, in the presence of the Savior. Third, anticipate future expressions of God's grace yet to be shown to you because of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ in your place. And no matter how bleak yesterday was, and you may have found it difficult to rejoice in the midst of that and to give thanks in the midst of that, meet it with the confidence that tomorrow could be an unfolding and a display of the grace of God like I've never yet seen in my life. Followers of Jesus Christ, who are serious about knowing God's will embrace that He has revealed His will to us in this much. Rejoice continually. Pray continually. Give thanks continually. Discover God's will in that. Remembering past mercies. Just reflecting on that will bring a smile on the face of people. You've been in situations where you wondered, am I going to make it through? Here you are. Here you are. You have the answer to that, don't you? Past mercy. Present promises. The Word of God is filled with promises. I commend to you Spurgeon's checkbook on the bank of faith, which he variously called checkbook on the bank of heaven. It's 365 devotions, a devotion for every day built around a promise from the Word of God. It's available in public domain. On the internet. You can search for it, find it, download it. I promise every day. Present promises. Promises spoken to you now. And anticipate future grace. I don't know what the future holds for me specifically. I know some aspects of it. But I'll tell you what I do know for you and for me. That God will yet, because He's taken us from one stage of glory to another stage of glory in our journey of progressive sanctification, He will yet show up in our lives and demonstrate grace to us like we have never imagined. Our God is able to do exceeding and abundantly above anything that we know how to ask or think. According to his power at work in us because of the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that as you seek to discover God's will for you, as I seek to discover God's will for me, that these three attitudes will be cultivated and overtake our lives in such a way that they will become dominant dispositions.